Interesting, we were just in Vrindavan a few days ago. We came directly from Vrindavan, at least myself and Rati had been in Vrindavan. She jumped up to us and she went across the Swiss. It was really hot over there. And it's really chilly over here. And of course, it had cooled down some in Vrindavan, it was 38 degrees. But it had been a little bit of raining, so it was very steamy. But being here with all of you warm South Africans, I'm sure that the atmosphere will be heated up during your time. Raji made some good points when he was speaking to us. And all of us have made an endeavor to come here. We've come from far and wide. And I came from Vrindavan. Basically, Kinshasa was in America. We flew back to Swiss and had about a day and came down here. Lucky came down. She was here or there, and then she was met to Kinshasa and Swiss came down. And you all had come from Johannesburg. You come here from Durban. You've come here from so many different places. You made an endeavor. And as Raji said, some of you called your bosses and told lies. But that's okay, because Krishna was a liar also. You made a lot of endeavors. You had to get in that car, you had to drive all the way over here, you know, 2 or 3 hours to get here. Now we've come to this beautiful place and we're all together. You made a big effort to come, for you to come. You made an effort to bring your body here. You made an effort to bring your mind here. So the soul is here, the body is here, and the mind is here. And for the next few days while we're all together, we should really make it a point that while we're in class or when we're in kirtan, we should make sure that we stay here and that we don't let the body or the mind give us an excuse for going away from this wonderful atmosphere. Because in this atmosphere, something nice will happen. In this atmosphere, we have Vaishnavas. When Vaishnavas come together, they like to do one thing specifically, and that is to immerse themselves in Krishna consciousness. They like to talk about Krishna. They like to sing about Krishna. They like to glorify Krishna. Naturally, and this is called becoming Krishna conscious. This is what Krishna consciousness means. It means that we come together and we talk about Krishna, we chant Krishna's name, we hear Krishna's glory, and then Krishna helps us. There is this verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam that probably everybody knows, but it speaks about the glories of Hari Katha, speaks about the glories of Krishna Katha, and in general it speaks of it. We can take kirtan, definitely, into the description which is being given there as well. And that verse explains that while these activities in Krishna consciousness are going on, there are three very important participants in the activity. Now, one participant is the speaker or the chanter. And the other participant, naturally, is the hearer of what's going on. So you have a speaker or a chanter, and you have those who are hearing. But there's a third participant also. And that third participant is Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is residing in all of our hearts as the Super Soul, as the Paramatma. And that verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam says that when devotees come together and they undertake this activity with full attention, then what Krishna does is he becomes very active right from within your heart. And things that seem inconceivable to us, things that seem very mysterious, or things that seem like things that we're always banging our heads on the wall thinking, how will this happen in Krishna consciousness? When we're very, very attentive while these activities are going on, Krishna reciprocates with his devotees, and very mystically right from within your heart, Krishna starts to make things very, very wonderful to happen. Like that verse says, Shunvata Swatata Krishna, Punya Shravana Kirtana, Vidyan Paksto Yabhadrani, if you do know these sort of sitams. It says that Sri Krishna, who is the personality of Godhead and who resides within everybody's heart, is the Paramatma. When he sees that the devotees are undertaking this most elevated, most pious, most refined form of activity, which is always absorbing and hearing about him, then he starts to take everything away from the heart, which is Bhadra. And Bhadra means inauspicious. Bhadra is auspicious, Abhadra inauspicious. So what we've come together to do this weekend is something that can't be achieved if you perform like thousands of yajnas, or like, you know, swahas, or if you're doing different types of tapashyas, or if you're doing different types of penances, or giving and charity, or doing so many things like this. By those activities, you can't achieve what we will achieve here by Krishna's mercy if we're very, very attentive in the process of hearing and chanting. That's a very wonderful thing. As like Raji, he mentioned that when we're coming here, we're focusing on our relationship with Krishna. Now, all of us know very, very well that Krishna and Krishna's name, they're absolutely the same. So when we're vibrating Hare Krishna, Krishna is present, and actually we're working on a relationship with Krishna. And for a long time, the relationship has not been good. And why is it? The relationship has not been good. Okay, first rule of order, when the speaker is speaking, everybody's got to be attentive, okay? So, we all have a relationship with Krishna. Nitya Siddha Krishna Prayama Saji Kavanoi. We have an eternal relationship with Krishna. But somewhere in history, the relationship went bad. And the relationship didn't go bad because of Krishna, but the relationship went bad because of something we did. And it's sort of like this.
I just turned my back on you. I turned my back on you. I stopped paying attention to you. I started checking out the speaker system. I started checking out the AC to see if some heat was coming out of it. I started neglecting you. And a long time ago, that's exactly what all of us did to Krishna.
Krishna is substance. Krishna is reality. But what we did is we turned our back on the reality and the beauty and the substance of Krishna. And what did we start doing? We turned around and we started becoming interested in shadows. And like when we look, we see like our shadows, and shadows can be like many of you know, I like to take photos. And sometimes I'm out someplace and the sun's on one side and I take a photo and you can see like this long shadow of Govinda Swami. Actually, the shadows look good because the shadows are always sort of slim instead of being big like me. But for a long time we've been interested in like shadows, shadows of reality, shadows of the real thing, shadows of substance, shadows of real beauty, shadows of what is our relationship with Krishna. But our get together this weekend is a great opportunity because it enables us to turn back to Krishna. When we're hearing the holy names, we can turn back to Krishna. Instead of like turning around, we come back to Krishna and we focus on Krishna. We're trying to chant with real absorption of the mind and real keeping everything here. And believe me, you know, we'll be sitting here in kirtan and your mind's going to come up with some reason. Let me turn away. Let me turn away from the kirtan. Let me check to see if what's going on Facebook. Or Raji said, you know, a WhatsApp message will come across. Or checking one thing or another. Or maybe you'll feel some ache and pain in your back. And your mind will say, better you get up and go outside and walk around for a while. Mind is always going to give us an excuse to turn away. But our business is to just keep turning back to Krishna. Turning back to Krishna. Turning back to Krishna. So we have this opportunity to do that this weekend by absorption in the holy name, absorption in Krishna Katha. And then miracles can happen. Literally, Krishna can cause miracles to happen right from within our hearts. Thanks, Swaroop. We were talking about like getting special hints from Krishna or getting messages from Krishna. And we were talking about how some people, they always seem to have that experience. And, you know, we were speaking like we pray and we pray and we, oftentimes we don't get these messages or these hints from Krishna. But, is this Srimadva Sattva Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtana? If we remain very absorbed, Krishna can do it. And he'll do it right from within our hearts. And he can do it for anyone, given the fact that we will be very, very attentive while we're doing it. I heard one nice description today I'd like to share with you. And it's a description about the Srimad Bhagavatam. It's a glorification of the Srimad Bhagavatam. But it's applicable in our situation because we're going to be together for the next few days and we want to focus nicely for the next few days. And this description that I heard is about two brothers. Okay. The two brothers, their names were Gokarna and Dundukari. Has anyone heard this description? Gokarna and Dundukari. Have you heard it? This is a Bhagavatam Mahatma or glorification, which is generally told at the beginning of like a Bhagavatam discussion. So there are two brothers, Gokarna and Dundukari. And one brother, he was a very, very good boy. And the other brother, he was a very, very bad boy. And the good brother was Gokarna. And the very bad brother, he was Dundukari. And he was really bad. I mean, he was bad. He was very, by his nature, he was very sensual. By his nature, he was attracted to very like lustful and very bad activities. And he was such a bad son that his father became completely, absolutely frustrated with having a son like that. And so one day the father said, I'm leaving. He said, I'm going to the forest. I can't even think that I had a son like this. And so he just got up and left home. And then Gokarna, he was such a nice, saintly young man. He was always going on pilgrimage to different holy spots. And he was always out. He was always drowning about on pilgrimage. So Gokarna was out. Father left home, and Dundurkali was there with his mother. And he was such a bad boy, he started beating his mother. And he started beating his mother and saying, give me your gold, give me your money, so that he could take the gold and he could take the money, and he would go out and use that for horrible things that we don't want to talk about here. I mean, like really bad things. And finally, the mother one day, she became so frustrated. She said, how can I live with a son like this? And so she went running out of the house, screaming. And there was a well outside of her house, and she saw the well, and she just jumped in the well and killed herself. And when that happened, when this Dundu came, he said, ha, now it's very nice. I have the home. I have whatever wealth there was. And then he started inviting prostitutes to live. And he was like really bad guy. I mean, he was like, you made your guy not a good beer. I mean, he was bad. And so, but he was such a horrible person that even the prostitutes that he was having to come and stay with him, they started to hate him because his qualities were so bad. So one day what they did is they tied him up to the bed and they took knives and they started stabbing this guy. But he was like really hard on the inside, he was hard on the outside, and he wasn't dying. And the prostitutes, they became, and he was screaming. And the prostitutes didn't know what to do. So what happened is they went to the fireplace where there were logs burning. And they brought burning logs and they stuffed inside of his mouth. Can you imagine? I mean, this is how much they hated this guy. They stuffed burning logs inside of his mouth, and then that great sinner, Dundurkali, he died. And when he died, he immediately became a ghost. Like a horrible ghost. So what happened is his brother Gokarna came back from going on pilgrimage, and he found that nobody was at home. And he slept in the home that night, and the first night that he slept in the home, all these evil things started happening. Ghosts started appearing and manifesting different forms, like, what are those things that you have in South Africa? Tuplush? I mean, what he was doing made the Tuplush look like good guys. I mean, he was like he's manifesting all these horrible forms. And because Gokarna was such a good Vaishnava and good Bhakta, he was just chanting Krishna's holy name and he wasn't affected by it all. And then finally, Dundurkali, he began to speak, and he said, Brother, you must save me. Do something to save me. I have this horrible, ghostly body. I've been such a wretched person. Please, brother, save me. And so the brother said, we have a situation. We have to do something to help my brother. So he began praying to Surya, the sun god. And when he prayed to Surya, the sun god, he got the answer. Your brother as to hear Srimad Bhagavatam from start to finish. So it's like hearing Krishna Katha or hearing the name of the Lord. He says he has to hear Srimad Bhagavatam from start to finish. And so what did Gokarna do? You know, he brought a whole group of Brahmins to his home. And they started reciting the Srimad Bhagavatam from start to finish. And while this was going on, all of the people from the village, they came. And they started listening to the Bhagavatam also. And so they spoke from start to finish, and when they finished the Bhagavatam, the last verse was finished, all of a sudden, you know, this very effulgent, transcendental form of Dundukari manifest. You know, just, you know, like effulgent, beautiful, transcendental form. And then an airplane came from Vaikuntha, and they told Dundukari, they said, please, it's time for you to go. Come with us. And so they put the sinner who had assumed this beautiful form on the airplane, and they were just starting to lift off and fly away. And all the villagers said, no, no, take us too. We all listen to the Bhagavatam also. So you should take us to Vaikuntha as well. And then the Vaikuntha Dutas, they spoke. And they said, no. He said, we can't take you. And they said, why? You're taking this man who was a sinner. Why don't you take us? And the Vishnudutas answered. They said, because when he was hearing, he heard with total attention, and he heard as if his very life depended on it. And when you heard, you were paying attention to your mobile phones. You were paying attention to Facebook. You know, you were checking out if the girls were looking at you. You were doing so many things. He heard with total attention and total faith as if his life depended on it, but you didn't. And if you want to go back, you have to have that full focus. Everything must be there. And then they took off. And then all the people in the village said, let's have another Bhagavad Katha. And then they organized the Bhagavad Katha, heard the Bhagavatam, and then they really paid attention to what was going on. And then, at the end of the Bhagavad Katha, last verse, airplanes came and they said, everybody get on board. And they all went back. It reminds me of one temple president that I knew in America. He was a very nice man, and he was good, nice devotee, you know. And he passed away. And when he passed away, he went up to the gates of Vaikuntha, and there was a queue for people to get into the spiritual world. And so he was standing in the queue, and there was a man in front of him. And then Krishna looked at the man in front of him, and he said, sir, what did you do when you were living in the world? And the man said, I was a taxi driver in Delhi. And Lord Krishna said, you go to the spiritual world immediately. And then the devotee, he looked at me and said, what were you doing when you were in the material world? He said, I was a temple president. And he said, you stay in the material world. So he got bewildered. And he said, why is it? He was just a taxi driver in New Delhi, and he went to the spiritual world. I was a temple president. You know, why am I supposed to stay here? And he said, because he was a taxi driver in Delhi. And when people sat in the back of his car, they prayed with so much attention. But when you gave Bhagavatam class, everybody fell asleep. So real attention is required. turning back to Krishna. Krishna Bahirmukhaji Bhogavanchakari. We became Bahirmukh, we turned away. And now our process for the weekend is just turn back. Turn back. Just turn ourselves around and face Krishna. And then let Krishna perform all of the miracles. And he will do it. We just have to make the effort. I think in the Bible it said, seek and ye shall find. We simply have to ask the Lord. Like recently I was in Beirut, Lebanon. And for 8 days after Kinshan of Prabhu left, each afternoon I was having an Arabic class with one Arabic teacher, and she's edited Srila Prabhupada's, the Bhagavad Gita as it is has been retranslated in Arabic. It was translated about 40 years ago or something like that, but it was not such a good translation. So it's been translated again, and this lady, she's edited it, and she's edited, I think, 5 other Srila Prabhupada's books that have been translated into Arabic. And she's a very devout Christian, very, very devout Christian. And every day we would have 45 minutes of class and we'd have 15 minutes of spiritual kata. And she was just explaining to me like the nature of her dependency and the nature of her deep affection and her, you know, like her relationship with Jesus Christ. And she told me, she said, Maharaj, listen to me. She said, I pray to him to help me. I think to ask him to help me. And because I think to ask him to help me, he always helps me. I can face the greatest problem in life, but because I'm consciously thinking and asking him to help me, he always helps me.
Sure.
Very, she's a very amazing lady. Very, very amazing. And so it's the same for us. If we think to ask Krishna, if we turn our face to Krishna, if we focus in the process of hearing about Krishna, whether it's hearing Krishna Katha, or whether it's absorbing ourselves and hearing the holy name, if we remain focused in that relationship, Krishna will help us. Because he says it in the Bhagavad Gita. He says right from within the heart, I will begin to remove everything that's bad so you can come back to me. So let's do that the next few days, nicely together, hear nicely, and chant nicely with absorption. And before we begin chanting, Raji mentioned that today is the disappearance day of His Grace Aindrapu, and I think that it's fitting that we all should remember Aindrapu because of his profound taste in chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra and his dedication to seeing that people throughout the world would become very, very much inspired and spread the holy names. I lived in Vrindavan at the time when Aindrapu lived there. I think he moved to Vrindavan in 86. He moved to Vrindavan in 86, and I went back to live in 87. And
was it 87 you said? I think it was just before Kartik of 86.
The Kinshan of Prabhu was just before Kartik of 86. He established a 24-hour kirtan in Vrindavan. So 86 till now, that means...
So almost 31 years.
31 years. 31 years. And he was very, very dedicated. through all the seasons in Vrindavan. And Vrindavan is, well, many, all of you know Vrindavan. Many of you have been there. Many of you have been there during Kartik, through the nice time. And many of you have gone during Gopadima time, which is still a nice time, you know. Vrindavan is an extreme place. Temperatures going up to 50 degrees in the summertime. Temperatures almost going down to zero in the wintertime. So much disease. So little electricity. I mean, can you imagine living in 50 degree weather and you don't even have electricity to make your fan move? And yeah, and all the crazy diseases that you get in Vrindavan, like malaria and jaundice and typhoid and everything. I understand there. Sitting in Krishna Balaram Mandir, sitting in front of the deities, chanting the holy names, focused on doing that for the pleasure of Radha Shamsundar. And then attracting legions of devotees who would come from all over the world to sit there with him in order to just chant. And for those of you who you've heard about Mahindra Prabhu, but maybe you heard one side. He was very strict in kirtan. He was very, very strict. You know, he wouldn't let devotees do any nonsense in the kirtan. And if you did nonsense in kirtan, if you weren't like paying attention, if you weren't focusing, if you were like messing around playing cartels or messing around playing mridanga, you could get a scream, you could get a slap, you could get like a 5-hour lecture after the kirtan. He was very deadly serious about his absorption in the holy name and service with the holy name and service to Radhe Shyam, and then spreading throughout the world. And I can say that prior to that period in our ISKCON society, although His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada, he gave us so many recordings of him singing bhajans and singing the songs of all of our acharyas. Basically, in ISKCON, we were, up to that point, we sort of only had like stand-up dancing kirtans. You know, I mean, many of us have been together for years, from Radharadhanath and other places, having those kirtans for hours and hours and hours, dancing in the tumba room and going wild and crazy. But I started having these kirtans where people would sit down and they would be focused. And it sort of ignited a fire and spread all over the world, you know, from him sitting there in Vrindavan and doing it in Vrindavan and training people to be very focused, you know, and not letting the mind wander during the kirtan. Then that mood sort of has spread all over the kirtan now. And that's why these, you know, His Holiness Sachidananda Swami Maharaj, she took it like a step further and he started having kirtan meetings, like these kirtan events. And all of us have attended kirtan meetings, and we've certainly attended kirtan meetings together. And I've seen some of the kirtan meetings. People are very, very focused. People undertake it like a big yajna. that we're getting into for the next few days, just to keep our minds focused in Krishna. Some are not like that. So. But our Indra Guru, he was very strict. And he wanted everybody to be so focused in chanting. So he did, he's done a great service, wonderful service, and we should all be, you know, very grateful and very thankful that such a dedicated and sincere disciple, Srila Prabhupada, did such a great service that throughout the world now people are having these long kirtans and long absorption with, you know, full dedication and full absorption. So we should be very thankful, you know, for Indra Guru for having done this for this kind of society.
Can you show me what to say a few words?
Thank you, Marsh. I'd also like to thank everyone. Very happy to be here. I'll try to just say a few words about Indra Guru. Indra Prabhu joined at a time in the Hare Krishna movement when Harinam Sankirtan was like the main focus. There was a story that before he had joined the temple, Indra found he followed a Harinam group in Washington, D.C., and he chanted with them for several hours. And at one point, one of the Matajis looked at his feet and realized that he had lost one of his shoes. And she said, "What happened to your shoe?" "Well, I lost it, you know, while we were chanting." Why didn't you go and, you know, go back to get your shoe?" He said, "No, I didn't want to go back to get my shoe. If I go back to try to find my shoe, I might lose your association." So at that time, it was before the ISKCON Society had a lot of books, and so book distribution wasn't as strong of a focus as the daily Harinam. And I am just told that he was part of a temple where there were about 20 devotees, and maybe 18 or 19 of those 20 devotees would go out every day for like 15 or 16 hours and do Harinam through the street. And at one point, the temple president wrote a report to Srila Prabhupada, and Srila Prabhupada answered with a letter saying, "I'm so pleased to hear about your 16-hour Sankirtan days." And so Indra always took that as like a great source of inspiration, that Srila Prabhupada was so pleased with all of their Sankirtan. Indra told us about the one thing that Srila Prabhupada had ever said to him. I believe it was at the Potomac Temple in Maryland, in America. Indra said that at one point in the morning, he was given the mridanga and he was asked to lead kirtan in a procession along with Srila Prabhupada. And so Indra said, "You know, I just played the mridanga in my simple way, and I just chanted from the heart as well as I could." And he said, and at one point, Srila Prabhupada turned to me, and he said the one word that my spiritual master ever said to me while I was in his association. He said, Srila Prabhupada turned to him and said, "Jai." And so Indra said, so I took so much inspiration that by doing that Harinam Sankirtan, I got a jai out of Srila Prabhupada. And he said, and that's been my inspiration ever since, that somehow by doing Harinam Sankirtan, I got a jai out of Srila Prabhupada.
Jai.
Jai.
At one point, Indra Prabhu was in New York, and you can do like a Google image search, and he put together this beautiful truck. It was like a box truck, And he arranged it so that it would open up, and he had these incredible golden arches that would go at the top. And he had like a little changing bodies diorama and a book table, and he had deities. And then he would just sit in the truck and do kirtan and distribute books and maybe distribute a little prasadam. And it's very beautiful. You can look it up online. He made it into one of the newspapers, one of the major New York City newspapers, within a week of starting that program. So at one point, the story was that Iyengar was feeling a little frustrated that the devotees were not as enthusiastic about participating in Harinam as he would have liked. He was feeling a little frustrated. Why aren't the devotees coming out and doing Harinam Sankirtan? They should be doing Harinam Sankirtan. And so one of his godbrothers said to him, Iyengar Prabhu, instead of complaining at the devotees that they're not coming out on Harinam, why don't you do Harinam in such an enlivening and inspiring way that others will feel inspired to do it with you? And so Iyengar said that he took that as like, you know, a great message from Krishna. And I think that's practically what he did. He worked on himself, and he manifested a type of Harinam that was very attractive and inspiring to many people. Like Maharaj was saying, that so many felt inspired to join him. Later he went to India. He had the inspiration to do traveling Harinam in India, but the 24-hour kirtan, Srila Prabhupada established the Krishna Balaram Mandir in 1975. And we've heard Srila Prabhupada really wanted a 24-hour kirtan. And the previous temple presidents, they all said that it was quite a difficult task to get that together. They were struggling, you know, maybe they could fill some time during the day. It was very difficult to get people that were dedicated enough to do Harinam all through the night. And so when Iyengar came to Vrindavan, the devotees asked him if he could do the 24-hour kirtan. And so he started it on Ram Vijayotsa, which is just before Kartik, in 1986. And he, like Marge was saying, he did it by just being completely fixed. He had like a small brahmachari ashram of core team members that could keep the schedule going. And then through thick and thin, he stayed in Vrindavan. Just a few more moments. In 2009, my Guru Maharaj had an inspiration to write a book where we interviewed different kirtaniyas. And so I approached Iyengar Prabhu with that idea, and I wasn't sure how he would react. He was kind of unpredictable. I thought he could just mock me and send me away. But he actually took it really seriously, and for two consecutive nights, we sat like late into the night. He spoke to me for hours and hours. If you want, you can go to my Facebook page in my notes, and you can find a transcription of that interview. In that interview, we discussed many topics about kirtan. It's really beautiful. I highly recommend. And Mother Yamuna, Srila Prabhupada's famous disciple who sings the Govindam prayers, when she read that interview, Mother Yamuna said, Mother Yamuna, her previous husband was the first temple president of ISKCON Vrindavan. And so I think the weight of Srila Prabhupada's desire for that 24-hour kirtan was very strongly in her mind. And she said after she read the interview and heard all of those realizations from Mahendra Prabhu, his realizations about doing kirtan, she said to us, you know, I'd heard different things about Mahendra Prabhu from my god sisters. But after reading that interview, she said, when Srila Prabhupada established the Krishna Balaram Mandir, I prayed and I prayed and I prayed in front of Radha Shama Sundar to please send somebody that could manifest the 24-hour kirtan. And then when I read that interview and I just heard all of Mahendra Prabhu's beautiful realizations about the holy name, I just was so astonished at what a beautiful devotee Radha Shama Sundar had sent to do the 24-hour kirtan. In that interview, we asked Mahendra Prabhu, why do 24-hour kirtan? What's the benefit of 24-hour kirtan? And he gave kind of a very amazing answer. He said, anywhere that Harinam is done, even after the performance of the kirtan, the atmosphere in that place becomes purified, becomes transformed. And anyone who will go into that atmosphere will be forced to become pious. So like now this weekend we'll have kirtan here in this conference hall. And next month or next year, when other people come to this conference hall, there will still be some residue from the kirtan. And those people will be positively influenced spiritually by coming in contact with this place, just because a kirtan had been done here previously. So he said, so even to go to a place where a kirtan was once performed will have a powerful impact on somebody's consciousness. So what to speak of if you go to a place and the kirtan is being performed right now? And he said, and what to speak of if you go to a place where the kirtan has been going on for years and years and years? And what to speak of if that's in a holy place where all of one's devotional activities are magnified thousands of times? So he said that's the benefit of 24-hour kirtan, is to create a powerful, transcendental, spiritual vibration. Anyway, I think we'll leave it there for now. Hare Krishna. Anger Bhagavan Ki.
Jai. And grace Anger Bhagavan Ki.
Jai.
Anger Bhagavan Ki.
Jai.
Shri Prabhupada Ki.
Jai.
Or Bhakti Vrinda Ki.
Jai.
Jai Gaur Vrindavan Ki.
Jai.